folks, we are live.
Fighting again today?
We got it.
I think I got it. I think I've got it, yeah. And I will have to pull this over here like that and then sit down.
Got plans.
Okay.
I
morning.
Morning.
Our service on page 3 of your bulletin or page 355 of your Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Their
Now, the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I'm warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To another he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. But Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Another said, I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said to him, no one puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Holy Spirit, guide us, speak to us, and stay with us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Before I get into the sermon itself, I have not heard that song in ages. It was really kind of fun for me to sing it. Back when I was in college, there was a church I went to, and that was the favorite song of the pastor. I don't think I've heard it for the last, like, 15 or 20 years. So, just kind of a nice little highlight for the morning. The whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. This morning, I'm afraid we need to address a topic I honestly hoped we would never have to discuss. Abortion. Simply in hearing the word, walls and defenses and political arguments and a variety of other things rush into our minds, activating our centers of fight or flight and preventing us from having any substantive conversations around the topic. That's one of the difficulties clergy face nearly every day now. Navigating a divided world where well-meaning people who claim to follow Christ find themselves on extreme ends of social situations that have become religious causes and moral crusades that have irreparably bound themselves to political ideologies. A few years ago, during the George Floyd protests, a conservative parishioner at my previous congregation warned me against speaking about political causes like Black Lives Matter. Days later, a progressive one contacted me and demanded that I preach on social and moral issues like Black Lives Matter. It's pretty hard to provide care of souls to an entire congregation with that kind of division inside of it, but my vows hold me to them. So this morning, I ask that we all do our best to calm our minds, no matter which triggers the topic might set off. I'm not trying to force anyone here to embrace my personal viewpoint. You don't have to agree with me now, and you don't when I'm still done speaking. We can continue to worship together and serve one another without forcing one another into some false sense of conformity. As we all know by now, this week, the Supreme Court radically changed the legal status of something that has been a right for all women in the United States since before I was born. The movement to repeal the legality was largely driven, or at least fronted, by religious entities and institutions. They claim a biblical mandate to eradicate abortion as an offense before God. That's what I was taught the entirety of my life up into my 30s. And that's what many people who have grown up in churches for the past few generations have heard, and how we've been trained. Abortion is against the Bible, therefore, we have to eliminate it from society. But calling this endeavor biblical is simply untrue. As a matter of governance and legality, abortion is certainly a political issue. Since it involves decisions surrounding someone's life, it is also an ethical or moral issue, and ethical and moral issues often carry a religious component to them. But to call it biblical in any way is to betray our own ignorance of what the Bible actually says. That is because the Bible never even mentions abortion. Not once. That means, in no uncertain terms, abortion is not a biblical issue. God is love is biblical, as the epistles directly tell us that. You shall not kill is biblical, as it appears clearly within Moses' Ten Commandments. You shall love your neighbor as yourself is biblical, appearing not only in Jesus' teachings, but in today's text from Galatians. Abortion, however, is not among the topics the Bible ever addresses, meaning there is no truly biblical statement or position regarding it. We know that abortion has existed throughout human history. Ancient writings mention it, and it isn't hard to figure out that people in desperate circumstances always have and always will find a way to eliminate a pregnancy. tells us that the Lord said, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. This is one of the main texts used to support the claim of full human life at conception, or fertilization, which seems to have risen to the preferred usage recently. It does look pretty straightforward when people spell it out. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you, indicates that God was fully familiar with the individual while still in utero. Therefore, God knows the embryo as a full human person, therefore, human life begins at conception / fertilization. So that's part A. Then secondly, if human life begins at fertilization, and God has commanded us that you shall not kill, then, as abortion is killing a full human person, abortion is against what the Bible says. We break it down into a pretty simple equation. A plus B equals C. Simple and straightforward, right? But the theology we've done is actually a lot more complicated than we assume. We've been skipping steps in our mind. If you break down the math I just did more fully, what we have looks a lot more like A is roughly equal to D is roughly equal to E is roughly equal to F plus B equals G, which is roughly equal to C. So, it seems we have a theological equation that involves not one simple act of addition, but several steps, assertions, and approximations. And even then, we haven't even really paid close enough attention to our original A statement, which contains two sections within it. A prime says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And A double prime says, before you were born, I consecrated you. In reality, what we've been working with as our initial variable is a conflation of those two statements. And we haven't even been fully considering what either one is saying. Looking more closely, each of those prime statements also contain two parts. The before section, and then God's action. So, spelled out more thoroughly, our equation is no longer A plus B equals C, but much more like A double prime part A plus A prime part B equals A, which is roughly equal to D, which is roughly equal to E, which is roughly equal to F, plus B equals G, which is roughly equal to C. If you accurately follow the logic all the way through, what you finally come up with would be an argument not about human life beginning at fertilization, but the pre-existence of human life. The idea of human life having begun before any sort of physical engagement whatsoever. And that would lead us into an entirely different argument and struggle than the one facing our society today. All arguments on both sides of the abortion issue, as well as many other political, social, / ethical issues, are like this. Theological concepts and analogies falsely bearing the claim of biblical authority. Now, that doesn't mean you can't have an opinion one way or the other, or strongly support a position. God has given you a mind and a moral compass, and expects you to use both. What it does mean is that we need to hold our positions with open hands, carefully approaching one another in love and mercy, rather than biting or devouring or consuming each other. The Bible is meant to guide us, not to impose new rules and laws upon us. It provides a scale against which we can measure ourselves and our local Christian community. Any attempt to use it as a weapon against one another or those outside the church is abuse, both of our neighbor and of the text itself. Take the Galatian vice list from this morning. Paul is writing to people within the Christian congregation, not to the general populace or regional government. And frankly, we keep using outdated terminology protect ourselves from what the passage actually says. Translated into more modern language, Paul tells us, carnality's actions are obvious. It's prostitution, pollution, molestation, idolatry, substance abuse, hatreds, strife, rivalry, hot tempers, conspiracies, discord, factionalisms, envies, perpetual drunkenness, carousing, and things similar to these, which I predict among you, just as I predicted before, that those practicing such kinds of things cannot inherit a godly realm. Paul isn't telling us how to judge outsiders to the Christian community. He's offering us a way to evaluate ourselves, to recognize our own faults so we can seek help from one another and amend our ways. I've spoken a lot recently about empire versus God's kingdom and how to recognize one or the other. And that knowledge is becoming more and more important by the day. As a reminder, empire always seeks to divide, to destroy, and to tear down. It demands uniformity of thought and action, and sows fear of the other, of our neighbors, so that it can continue to dominate society and bend us to its will. It cares for nothing but its own power and will use any means to maintain control. Empire exists at every level of human society, from relationships within a single family all the way up to international politics. All of us are prone to take up the power of empire and use it for our advantage. And all of us are bound, at one time or another, to fall beneath its sway. The reign of the heavens, the realm of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, does not and cannot function like empire. It's a complete alternative, where empire relies on the threat of failing to grasp resources for itself. Christ's people give freely, trusting that God's kingdom will provide not necessarily excess, but enough for all. Where empire relies on war to instill fear of our neighbor and define its own oppressive definitions of loyalty, Christ's people are called to love their enemies through action and pray for those who oppress them. Where empire uses death to frighten us into enslaving ourselves to it with the entirety of our being, Christ offers us an entirely new and boundless kind of vitality, what the Bible calls eternal life. And where empire employs domination to enforce its will and maintain uniformity, Christ's people work for unity within our differences and diversity, for reconciliation with the other, and for a world of true peace. Empire will and does use anything it can to corrupt and poison not only society in general, but the kingdom of God as well. Moral causes, social issues, governmental policy, theological arguments, even the words of the Bible itself. And it uses those same tools to deceive us into thinking we're doing God's work while actively causing harm to the very neighbors we see Christ calling us to serve. With so much manipulation and distortion taking place around us, it's important that we make the effort to watch ourselves carefully these next few months and years, and to take the time necessary to discern before judging or condemning our neighbors. Are we responding to any given situation as those subjugated to empire? Or are we choosing to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly, to behave and respond as the children of God that we already are? Each law has been fulfilled in one statement. You will act in your neighbor's best interest, the same as for yourself.
We believe in one God.
We believe in one God.
Father, the Almighty.
Maker
of heaven and earth.
Of all that is
seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ.
The only Son of God.
Eternally God the Father.
God
from God.
Light
from light.
True God from true God.
Begotten not made.
Of one being with the Father.
Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit,
he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary,
and entered into man. For our sake, he was crucified upon his side. He suffered death and was buried.
On the third day,
he rose again,
in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascends to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord and giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son.
With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified.
He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism
for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
by what we have done and by what we have lived under. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Then also on Thursday, we have our Healing Eucharist at noon in the Kendrick Chapel.
of the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. By water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Hallelujah.
The disciples knew the Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread. The disciples knew the Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread. The bread which we break, alleluia, is the union of the body of Christ. The disciples knew the Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread. One body are we, alleluia, for though many we share one bread. The disciples knew the Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen. And you have fasted the spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God.
Ha 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 ha!